You've tuned in to Unpause Your Life with Dr. Kelly Estes. Your access to success strategies and more to help you move onward and upward with your life. Listen in each week as she interviews others who have really taken their essence to the next level and truly unpause their life. Now, here's your host, Dr. Kelly Estes.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to the show. This is Dr. Kelly Estes, and I am founder of the Addictions Academy, the Addictions Coach, and Rehab Rescue. Welcome to Unpause Your Life. This is a great podcast where we showcase people who have done something extraordinary with their life. I welcome you, and I hope you enjoy all of our guests.
On my way, found a reason to wake up another day.
Before we get started, let's hear this short message from one of my supporters.
All the things that you won't do.
Did you know 81% of Americans would like to become a published author? Chances are you might be one of them. What's stopping you? Writing and publishing a book takes a lot of work and is expensive, right? Well, not anymore. For your next book project, or even your first, team up with Hassle-Free Books. They make it so easy to become an author. They remove all of the fuss and struggle and make it smooth and simple. And it's far more affordable than you could ever imagine. Go to hasslefreebooks.com and use promo code UNPAUSE to receive a 10% discount off of any book project. Get started right away and become a published author in as little as 45 days. For your free one-hour book formula guide, which will show you just how painless it can be to become an author, head to hasslefreebooks.com today.
All right. Thanks again for joining me. Let's get started with today's show.
I took a walk down the dark road where they said that I shouldn't go.
Welcome to Unpause Your Life with Dr. Kelly Estes, the Addictions Coach and the Addictions Academy. Today, my guest is Jeffrey Lynn Esquire, and he is a law partner in a multi-county Florida law firm of Bagley, Merrick, Udell, and Lynn, with a Boca Raton-based consulting practice focused upon zoning, real estate, business structuring, marketing, licensing, regulatory compliance, and litigation in the substance use disorder treatment and sober living resident provider space. He was appointed by Palm Beach State Attorney Dave Ehrenberg to serve on the Sober Homes Task Force and is also the editor of the blog Sober Law News. Welcome, Jeffrey Lynn.
Hey, how are you?
Good, how are you? I am excited to have you.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity.
So we'll get right into it. I want to talk about patient brokering, body brokering, selling clients to treatment centers, everything you see on the news.
Oh, you know, that's a big topic because I think that there's a lot of misunderstanding, you know, and in this space, in particular in the substance use disorder treatment space, there's a lot of misunderstanding about not only what the law is, but why it's there. And, you know, in short, first of all, not every state has an anti-patient brokering law. So let's just be clear on that. There is a federal law that only pertains to Medicare, Medicaid, TRICARE, any federally funded program, where you cannot pay a person a kickback or anything for a referral. And the reason that the federal law has created that concept has to do with a bunch of healthcare policies, but mostly that we want patients making healthcare decisions for themselves, and we don't want a physician's healthcare corrupt. Their decision making corrupted by having by the opportunity to buy patients. For instance, if I could give you money to see me as a lawyer, as opposed to choosing a better lawyer, then why do I have to be good? I don't have to be a good lawyer because I'm giving you something of value to choose me. So in healthcare, which we hold to a very high regard, we want to make sure our healthcare providers are providing the best healthcare they can, and for them to focus on patient-centered care. What's happened is that, and that concept has existed for a long time. What's happened in certain states, particularly Florida, which, you know, we laugh at the state that created, you know, you take a fraud and we perfect it here. In Florida, there were a lot of car accident fraudulent schemes going on. So the state didn't have a mechanism to really deal with that. So they created the State Patient Brokering Act, which is modeled after the federal anti-kickback statute, to say, listen, if you're doing anything, forget federal Medicare, Medicaid, if you're doing anything in healthcare space where you're paying for a referral, where you're offered something for a referral, you're buying a patient, you're giving something of value for them to make a healthcare decision, that's against the law. The law does not say you cannot patient broker. It's just the name of the statute. Now, Florida has that statute. It's my understanding California does not have that statute. So you have different states that have different marketing schemes based upon how to get patients. And I guess that's really the key. People think that patient brokering is inherently evil. And between you and me in this space, it is, for reasons we'll talk about later. But the problem, the core problem that we have and why patient brokering is such a big deal in our conversation in this space is because it's difficult for treatment providers to sell their services in the marketplace. How are they going to present themselves and distinguish themselves as federal providers? What markers do we use? What metrics do we use to measure them by outside of word of mouth and referrals? And in this space, for instance, if someone wanted to move to get treatment for just talk about drug addiction, general drug addiction. We all know now, where does everyone go to find that? They're not going to go to their primary care physician because their primary care physician is going to say, I don't know where to send you. And if there is a place that's local, they're either going to, someone's going to say to them, oh, you really shouldn't stay local. You should travel. You should leave your place of origin. Your family of origin is going to cause triggers and other problems. So there's that concept of you should really leave your setting to change that. And that's arguable. But more importantly, a lot of cities and counties throughout the country do not have robust drug and alcohol treatment, mostly because they don't want it there. There's an inherent long-term discrimination with drug and alcohol treatment and people are labeled addicts. And so you have fewer places that actually provide a holistic, campus-style, full-setting treatment. So how do you, as a treatment provider, let the marketplace, the consumers, know you exist? Well, you can do it through billboard advertising. You can do it through TV advertising. But that's just not how current marketing is done. It's done through Google, and it's done through online services. And so what ends up happening is that there's this great competition in the online marketplace for patients. And for your listeners, they may have been following about what's been happening with Google as of late, and Google's finally taken a stand and gotten itself a little bit more active with regard to how it's used or misused with regard to marketing. So the patient brokering issue really is a marketing issue, is how is a treatment provider going to get patients? And because of the cost of acquisition of a patient is so high, what has ended up happening, it's created a marketplace, particularly in Florida, where someone would move here and move into a sober living residence and then would go to a treatment center. But that patient has value. They're a commodity now. They have value through their insurance card. And so you have vultures flying around them. Someone who is obviously not doing very well, else they wouldn't be in treatment. They aren't established in their recovery. Who is very vulnerable, who now is being circled by vultures who are trying to, for lack of a better word, sell them to a treatment center as a, quote, marketer. So you have, there are some people who do that and do it altruistically. And funny, we call them interventionists. And those are people who have historically been hired by families or others to intervene in someone who wasn't ready to get themselves into treatment, who wasn't ready to acknowledge they've hit bottom, who hasn't able to look at themselves in a mirror and recognize they have a drug or alcohol problem that's overtaken their lives. And those interventionists have a storied, reputable career in our nation's history. what's happened is, as we leap forward to the opioid epidemic, and that coupled with the flow of money coming from insurance due to the Affordable Care Act, all of a sudden the interventionists that existed found themselves overrun by people who would simply call themselves marketers, who had no background and no basis to be placing patients other than acting as a middleman.
I'll stop you for 1 second. So, yeah. Okay, so we went from a model of traditional marketing, which is referral, you know, word of mouth. I've been doing this 21 years. So it was, I refer to you, you refer to me. There's no cash exchange, no gift cards, nothing, to all of a sudden, there's a treatment center on every corner, a church, a bar, and a treatment center. And we hired these marketers, these business outreach developers, to go into the communities and find people and put them in treatment. Now, how is it that some states allow that and some states say, that's patient brokering. And then some say, well, it's okay if they're on salary, they're not paid per patient. Where does that get convoluted in the law space?
Okay, now what you just described, outreach people, go out in the community, get patients, that continues to be completely lawful. What the law says, it doesn't always make sense, but what the law says is you cannot pay for a referral. But what you can do is you can enter into an agreement with someone, an employee or not, could be an independent contractor, who's going to go out and is going to be your outreach coordinator to sell your services about how great you are, your treatment center is, and is going to, you know, I kind of laugh. If you ever see people standing on a corner, you know, they're spinning a sign around. It's an arrow. Come, you know, dogs for sale over here. It's kind of like what they're supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be out there, you know, as a walking billboard, as a walking talking piece about your treatment center. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's illegal. What becomes technically illegal, and I say this because I want to distinguish that between, you know, morally, you know, unethical or just immoral, is what becomes technically illegal is if you pay that person for a referral. So if I say, every time you bring me a patient, I'll give you $500, that's illegal because, one, you then as the marketer are saying, wow, if I can get a patient for $500, I'm going to go get as many patients as I can. And now you're, as a salesperson or outreach coordinator or marketer, you are clearly motivated by money and less motivated by selling the services of the employer. So that's part of the problem. Remember, if I can pay per patient, it doesn't matter. Then I don't really care about the quality of my services because I'm going to pay you for a patient. And if you're not successful bringing me a patient, I don't have to pay.
So let me recap that because the
agreement, though, why pay you a flat rate, you know, success or not? And then the risk is on me that you're not going to bring me patients. What's happened in reality and unethically, it's unethical because it's illegal, but also immoral, is that these outreach coordinators, in order to get patients, have started to offer the patients things of value, free rent, you know, free room and board, beyond just, hey, we really need to help you. And I think that's where the confusing point is also, is, you know, we've gotten to the point. So we start with the business model of, hey, I know you, you know me, you're a great provider, I'm a good provider. Let's, you know, if I can't handle this patient, I will send them to you if you can, and vice versa, because we respect each other's credentials and experience and professionalism. That's crossed into literally bartering in patients like commodities, where I no longer really care about the patient's clinical outcomes. I just know you have a detox, I have an IOP. And so a patient's brought to me that I can't use, so I give them to you as a detox patient, and then I know you'll give them to me as an IOP patient, and we just run them through insurance. And what has happened from a public policy standpoint is, that's actually has happened historically, but no one really paid attention to it. When the opioid crisis hit in, you know, the early 2000s, mid-2000s, coupled with the explosion of sober living residences as the Florida model, because insurance has pushed outpatient as a treatment modality for opioid addiction as opposed to alcoholism, you have a very large demand for services coming from a younger population, you know, who are hooked on opioids, heroin, or pills. They're on their parents' insurance. The parents don't know what to do. The parents then are completely reliant to their detriment upon these salespeople, these outreach coordinators, to help get their loved ones into care. And because those loved ones really don't want to be in care, remember, we're not dealing with interventionists anymore, you're dealing with just marketers, everyone's just along for the ride. And it's caused a lot of negative consequences, not only for the delivery of healthcare services, but in communities. We've seen sober living residences that are not, they're flop houses that really don't belong in neighborhoods because they don't even function like a recovery residence. It's simply a fraternity house for people who are hanging out while they're not in group meetings. But most importantly, I think that there's been a further entrenchment of the stereotype of people with addictions and their service providers. And that's sad because we have fought for so many decades to get where we are today, which is insurance coverage for everyone with mental health and substance use disorders. The Parity Act makes sure that insurance does pay for those services. Federal cases reinforcing the right of people to live in a house of their own choosing in recovery. We've come so far with social policy and civil rights that the whole thing of now patient brokering and the scourge of patient brokering, of the human trafficking of patients, has reinforced the stereotype that there's something wrong with addicts, that there's something wrong with their treatment providers. And, you know, we're now going to apply different rules to them because, Callie, between you and me, kickbacks and patient brokering and everything happens throughout all healthcare. You can look at Office of Inspector General reports from HHS on a daily basis, and they are arresting and prosecuting very well-regarded healthcare providers for doing the same exact thing, except they're doing it with Medicare and Medicaid.
Right.
So, you know, it's kind of funny that you never hear about that in the news, but all you hear about is about the patient brokering going on in this space. Let me leave you with this thought is this. The problem here is that when you patient broker a young person with addictions, you have now taught them, one, it's acceptable. Two, they see how much money can be made. You know, and three, you know, they're already don't want to be in treatment, most of them. And that's being, I know, generalizing, but that tends to be the statistic, that they have not hit bottom, they are not invested in their own recovery, and right off the bat, you are teaching them that they can prostitute themselves with their insurance card to get free things, to get, you know, a better place to live, or get a scooter, or a gym membership, or, you know, or a vape, or whatnot. And so it's reinforcing their negative behaviors already. And we're not getting anywhere. We're not getting towards healing, or we're not getting towards recovery, or we're not getting towards cure. And that's the immoral scourge that patient brokering has in this specific healthcare sector.
Okay. So the media, I would say then, has taken a problem that we have within our industry, within our ranks, and expanded upon it to the point now where these people watching television and listening to the radio are now saying the entire industry is corrupt and everybody's patient brokering and every treatment center has a problem. And now we've got an even bigger problem. We've got people not in the industry, such as mothers and fathers and cousins and such, attacking the industry, assuming that everybody is patient brokering, because the one or two or three or four bad apples that we're arresting and putting in jail for true patient brokering has given such a tainted name to the addiction industry. Now that professionals such as myself and other treatment centers, we're almost afraid to operate in the market space in Florida because of the negative backlash.
Yeah, let me start with your last point. Florida has historically been and continues to be one of the greatest locations to obtain substance use disorder and mental health services. It's historic, it's storied, it's been here for a long time, and because of that, there's a very robust and healthy and proud recovery community. So people move here not just to get those healthcare services, but to, you know, to continue their recovery beyond treatment, because treatment is not the end-all be-all like it is in a medical procedure.
Right.
The longer-term recovery process and the support from a greater recovery community that not everyone can get from their family. So now that being said, you're absolutely right. What, in my my opinion. Now, this is just my personal opinion, but I stand by this opinion until someone shows me otherwise. From what I've seen for 20 years of law practice, is that it, and being a native Floridian myself, people, do not like others moving to Florida that do not, quote, contribute to the economy. And if you want to come here for health care, that's great. So long as you go home, or if you buy a house, great. That's wonderful. But if you are moving here as an addict, we don't want you here because you're an addict. And that's been like that nationally everywhere. We've gotten to the point now where some people say, yes, we believe in drug and alcohol treatment. Just do it somewhere else. We call them the NIMBYs. Not in my backyard, NIMBY, the zoning term. So you've gotten to the point where we don't want those people here anymore. And they've discriminated against that population, both as against people like yourself, service providers, and against the addicted, the afflicted for generations. And again, we've made great strides getting away from them. But now, with this negative press, it's reinforced, again, these stereotypes that people have had. At the local level, but because now of the way the news works and it's taken on a national flavor because the opioid crisis is national and Florida is the recovery capital of the United States. And that's a positive. That's a positive compliment that, as opposed to California being the rehab Riviera, we're about recovery. We're not about rehab here. It's about you can get treatment anywhere, but we're about long-term recovery, and that's really where Florida has made its mark. What has happened is you have parents, some, who are understandably ignorant or naive or not directly involved with their children's health care in this space. And by the way, why would they? That's part of the reason the patient brokering law exists, because it recognizes that a consumer in the healthcare space cannot readily be educated. It's difficult. We are very reliant upon three professions in American culture: our doctors, physicians, our healthcare providers, lawyers, and accountants. Those three professions are held to a very high standard because consumers cannot readily distinguish between those service providers. So in the healthcare space, what has happened is that you have a parent who, and I give this to your listeners. This is a fantastic, my favorite exercise to do is to pretend that your loved one, your child, the person most important to you, you just got a call that they were in the hospital. They got picked up by fire rescue for overdosing. And this is the first you're hearing about it. You pick them up at the hospital. You are told your child has a very high likelihood of overdosing if they use drugs again soon because they obviously have some problem. You're panicking. You can't take them back to the hospital because the hospital doesn't provide these services because historically we've carved out drug and alcohol treatment from healthcare services. So where do you take them? You, if you look in your insurance and go, well, is there a local place to take them? Is there an in-network place to take them? There likely is not. So you start getting on Google, and you start looking around. And that's where, again, it goes back to the patient brokering and the fight over patients by treatment providers. So once you have a parent who has been has had a bad experience, and statistically it's likely they're going to have a bad experience overall, then what's happened is this next level, which I affectionately call the Mother's Mafia on Facebook, where rather than trying to identify a problem and address it, it's almost like throwing out the baby with the bathwater. They have joined forces from a populist standpoint with law enforcement to indict the entire industry under the guise of we need to throw out the baby with the bathwater, we need to break the mold and start all over again. And that's simply not the case. There is so much good that comes out of treatment. The problem are the insurance providers. They don't want to pay for services. So the treatment providers become subjected to what insurance is going to pay for. But again, parents don't understand that. They understand very little of this. They just simply are looking at a healthcare provider. Please help me. Please take care of my child. So you have this angst and anger from parents, stereotypically more mothers than otherwise. You have the addicts, mom, you have these groups online, who, you know, some of them are phenomenal human beings behind these groups, but, you know, a group is made up of individuals, and you have a lot of people who will use social media, in my opinion, inappropriately, and will effectively slander and treatment providers in the entire industry, and they hide behind their computers doing that, and they're not only are they furthering the stereotype, but they're actually hurting their own ability to get good services and treatment for their own children.
I experienced that firsthand. I actually had a lady who jumped on my Facebook and said, "How dare I make a living off of poor and suffering addicts?" And I said, "What do you mean?" And, you know, I have 21 years experience. I'm a PhD, you know, $100,000 in student loans. I've paid my dues with training. You know, I deserve to be paid for my services. And she said, "I should work for free, that this is a disease of addiction." Well, I went to her wall, and she's a cancer nurse. So I hit her up and I said, "Is cancer considered a disease?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Do you collect a paycheck?" And she said, "Well, of course." I said, "So how is it that you work with a disease, cancer, and you collect a paycheck, but I work in the disease of addiction, and I'm a horrible, awful person that's making money off of addicts?" And she said, "That's different." I said, "How is that different? Both people are suffering from a problem. And how do you have the misconception that all of us should work for free to save your kids? You're out there telling people I'm a horrible person charging for my services, but you're doing the same." And I got her thinking. And I said, "This is what's wrong in our industry. You don't allow us to do our job, because we're doing our job trying to help people. And here you are saying we're not doing it a certain way, yet you have no knowledge of what we do." I don't know the first thing about being a cancer nurse. I wouldn't pretend to do that. So why do we have these moms and these, I call them the vigilante moms, where they think they're helping everybody, and it's like a bunch of 14-year-old girls following the leader. And the leader says, "Go left." They all follow left and have no idea what they're doing. And I watched them put two treatment centers out of business online just by posting false information. And the two treatment centers couldn't recover. So how do we stop that problem? So not only do we have issues within our own industry of patient brokering that we're trying to curtail, but now we have outsider influence when there shouldn't be any. What do we do?
Yeah, you know, well, outside of, you know, taking legal action against them individually for actions they do, there's very little that you can do. And that really is the, you know, the brave new world of social media. And Callie, to be honest with you, it's actually economic terrorism, because I've had a client who experienced the same thing. And I'll give you an example. There was a mother whose child was placed with a treatment center here in South Florida, and because that child was above the age of 18 and did not consent to her mother's involvement in her care, because she claimed her mother was the cause or one of the bases of a triggering mechanism of her using drugs, the treatment center, under HIPAA laws and under other regulations, said, "Okay, you are not consenting, even though it's on your mother's insurance, you are not consenting to her staying involved. Okay, that's the way it is. They have to follow the law." The mother then went onto Facebook and found these mothers groups. And again, they're not all mothers, but they tend to mostly be mothers. Plenty of fathers are involved. But went to one of these groups and was identified by a local self-declared advocate who said, "Oh no, your child is been kidnapped. We need to go and brainwashed. We need to go rescue your child." So, not knowing what to do, and this parent, again, being completely vulnerable, relied upon this self-declared advocate to take action. And what ended up happening was this self-declared advocate and her group went to local news stations and started making allegations that this patient had been kidnapped, is being brainwashed, is being kept against her own will. And then that news agency barged into this treatment center's treatment space with a camera, started filming them and intimidating everyone based upon this information that had no basis in reality. When the daughter patient found out about this, she called her mother and said, "Mom, what the heck are you doing?" And after a conversation, the mother was completely apologetic. She said, "I'm sorry, I haven't heard from you. I didn't know what to do." And, you know, meanwhile, there's all of this emails and information that the daughter is doing very well, and the treatment center was doing very well by the daughter. But that treatment center, because of these vigilante moms thinking that, you know, their ends justify their means, basically put this treatment center out of business, because the second local news put on the air that this treatment center has done, you know, done this, you can't really sue the news for slander, because they're reporting a story of the information that they have and the certain privileges that the press has, if they're acting in good faith. And they were acting in good faith, the press, the local TV station. So where is the recourse for these vigilante moms? Again, it's like a terrorist. They think that their ends justify their means, that they are going to do whatever they can to save the children from these unscrupulous treatment providers. But if you talk to these moms, if you talk to these, what we call these vigilantes, they have their own agenda. And their own agenda is to eliminate the entire treatment industry. Their agenda is that it's been completely corrupted by private money, and we need to stay with a 12-step model, which includes you are not to take any money for the delivery of services. The irony of that is that the industry itself, people with, mostly starting with alcoholism, and starting out of Hazleton, probably in Minnesota, learned a long time ago that, first of all, 12 steps aren't for everybody, though the sense of community that you obtain from a 12-step fellowship probably is necessary. But you don't necessarily need to do a 12-step program. Even if it works, you have to accept it and embrace it. For some people, it's very cultish. It's very dogmatic. It seems to come from a religious base. So a lot of people, particularly the young people, don't necessarily aren't pulled towards it. Secondly, a lot of those younger people are not ready for their own recovery, and the 12-step program requires absolute, you know, personal responsibility and involvement. So you take this concept of, you know, 12 steps work and the 12-step fellowships, and now you say, well, no, but we have a medical model that insurance will pay for. Now, we have fought as a society tooth and nail for insurance to pay for treatment, and then you turn around and you have these vigilantes who, it's almost like religion. For them, it's unthinkable that anyone would charge a dime to provide this type of healthcare service, but at the same time, it's completely okay to tithe the church or to pay your synagogue for services. They think that this should all be done for free, and that is simply not realistic. Besides not being realistic, it's almost like a religious fight for some of these people, and I find that to be probably the largest inhibitor of allowing the industry to correct itself and to grow, because it's getting attacked on all different sides. And why would anyone like yourself today, if you were today going through social work school or psychiatric school or psychology school or anything, and knowing all this, why would you want to subject yourself to this kind of environment? Meanwhile, the demand can never be higher for services. We need to professionalize this industry more and more, because the opioid epidemic is not going anywhere, and drug addiction and alcoholism are as long as the beginning of time. You know, I joke, I'm of the Jewish faith, and I always laugh now if we ever have a prayer, and they do a prayer, thank you, God, for giving us the fruit of the vine. You know, we don't thank God for water, but we thank God for wine. You know, I kind of find that funny. So, you know, there's been drug use and misuse, abuse and addiction since man existed. It's not going anywhere. And yet I think a lot of these parents, you know, are looking, not all, some are looking to blame anyone but themselves for the situation that their family is in.
I'm going to stop you right there, because that's exactly correct. When I deal with these parents and I say, you have to look at the role you're playing in what is going on, they look outward. I'm not a bad parent. It's not my fault she's using drugs. And I always say, yes, it is. And they're shocked when I say that, because I say, to some degree, you have participated in the activity. Maybe you did it unknowingly and don't understand addiction, which is fine. Let's educate you so you know what you're doing wrong to correct it. But you can't say, fix my kid, I'm a bad parent, fix my kid, but do it for free. And I say to people, I can't fix 25 years of bad parenting in 30 days. And they're shocked when I say that, because I say to the moms and dads, there's something wrong here. You've known this has been going on for a period of time. You've given them money. You've given them the car. You've done everything wrong. And then you want me to work for free and fix all your parenting mistakes. And I'm very direct about that. And a lot of these moms that I see online, it's like they don't want to realize they had any role in this mess. So they project outward onto everyone else, and then they get caught up in one of these little fanatical leaders who wants to save everybody. And she starts off with a great idea. Let's save the industry. Let's save our kids. Let's fix it. But then it becomes about the following she gets. Now she's got a following of 30, 40, 50, 500, 5,000 moms that are looking up to her for answers, and she has no knowledge in the addiction space. So she starts making stuff up. And as she does this, she's hurting people in the process and causing, you know, a downfall. And there are these closed Facebook groups where all they do is complain. And it amazes me. 45-year-old women, 50-year-old women bitching about everything. And I'm shocked. I'm like, you're not solving anything. All you're doing is complaining and getting attention to be complained upon. So,
yeah, but like in any other populist uprising, you know, those 500 or 5,000 moms, they vote where a treatment center doesn't vote, or you have one vote. So when it comes to the development of public policy, when it comes to law enforcement, when it comes to utilizing governmental resources to fix the problem, rather than, you know, it's one thing to allow them to have a seat at the table, absolutely. But when they are the loudest voice and anyone who disagrees with them is deemed to be corrupt or deemed to be wrong, that's where we start running afoul of medicine and we start going by popularity. And I think that, again, we keep coming back to how easy it is to stereotype and to stigmatize and to ostracize the drug and alcohol treatment and recovery community. It just, for some reason, I don't know why. I'm not a social scientist, but I can tell you that from just reading treatises and studying the issue, it's part of our American culture. We have always kicked the person who is down. We've certainly always, you know, kicked the drunk. We've always certainly punished the drug user for having a failing of morality and constitution. So when you take that paradigm, even if you are the parent of a child that has a problem, you can't accept it. Now, I got to tell you, on the flip side, there are some parents that I have met at task force meetings in Palm Beach County or just otherwise who have just been wonderful. But that's because they found good support. And let me just give you the opposite side of that. I heard this great story. It's an anecdote called the casserole story about a woman who's, you know, there were two women who had children in the hospital. One was there for cancer and the other one was there because their child tried to commit suicide. And the child who was there for cancer, all of the neighbors would bring casseroles and food to the home so the mother and the family didn't have to cook and they could be with their child. For the parents of the child who tried to commit suicide, everyone stayed away. Because that was like a pariah. That was an uncomfortable conversation. There was no support for that parent whose child tried to commit suicide. So there's very, and to extrapolate, there's very little support for a parent who says, hey, listen, my kid's got drug addiction, and I'm probably something complicit in that. Where are they going to go to get that support so that they don't have toxic shame themselves that they are the cause or complicit or have somehow contributed to their child's drug addiction? The only place they can turn to are these mothers groups, these parents groups on Facebook and online. And therefore, by getting that support, and they are told, you are not complicit, you have no involvement, this has nothing to do with you, it has everything to do with your child, or worse, it has nothing to do with your child, it has everything to do with the pharmaceutical industry, and your child is simply a victim and your child has no personal responsibility, which is really also a fallacy. I can understand where you get these large followings of these groups who go out and rally and march, and they want to take the entire industry down. I understand it, because you have these parents who are not otherwise supported in society. We will continue, even though you have a doctor, let's say, who prescribed OxyContin or any other substance that someone became addicted to, or even if a child was using an illicit substance, we are so fast to blame the parent that the parent is not prepared to be introspective. And why would they be prepared? Again, if they were prepared to be introspective, they would take on a different tack. I've met parents who were much more grounded or did have that level of support, found that kind of group meeting for themselves, for parents of that. Because, again, it's cliche, but the opposite of addiction is not sobriety, it's community, which comes full circle to why Florida is a recovery community capital, because we have such a great community here. And what law enforcement doesn't understand that they're doing, and city governments don't understand, and these parents, is that they are undermining the decades of community fabric that's been interwoven in these towns like Delray and Palm Beach County, that has been a bastion of hope and saving for countless thousands of people. Granted, there's been this influx of treatment providers that are unscrupulous and corrupt. But even back to an earlier point you made about, you know, we're talking about patient brokering, whatever. There have only been 33 or 34 arrests made in this space. And of all of those arrests made, at least at the state level, I don't believe any of them, and I might be mistaken, any of them were egregious, horrible situations. The only horrible situation out of a bad movie was the situation with Kenny Chapman, who, yeah, that's what made national news, rightfully should have made national news. But the joke there is the state government had really no resources to take care of it. Picked the federal government to come in. And then everyone knew in the industry that Kenny Chapman existed, and everyone has gone to law enforcement for years saying, why aren't you putting this person out of business? Everyone knows what's happening there. We hear the stories. Why aren't you doing anything? So it wasn't until there was a public outcry and there was some money given that law enforcement finally went in and did something about it. And then all of a sudden, oh, look what we found. We found this entirely corrupt industry. And while I'm very friendly with our local state attorney, he is aware of my frustration with the comment made on national news that it's the entire industry's corrupt. I can understand, as a former prosecutor, all you see are people who are being arrested. You don't see the people not being arrested. So after a period of time as a prosecutor, yes, that's all you're seeing is a corrupt industry. You're not seeing the good part of the industry because you're not investigating them because there's no reason to. Plus, overwhelmingly, the industry is well-intentioned. Overwhelmingly, the industry is filled with good people like yourself. But, you know, Kelly, at its core, it's filled with people who themselves either are in recovery or have an affinity towards helping people in recovery. You don't see doctors and other medical professionals and scientists flocking to addiction treatment to cure it and to bring it into 21st century healthcare, because there was never any money in it before, until now. Only now, with insurance being mandated to pay for drug and alcohol treatment, for the first time is there any source of interest for healthcare providers like this, you know, like this oncology nurse you were talking about. You know, if there was no money in oncology nursing, she wouldn't be doing that job unless she wanted to volunteer. The same thing in addiction treatment. If there's no money, who's going to pay for your mortgage? Who's going to pay for your car? Who's going to pay for your gas? We all need to be self-responsible, self-reliant. So this is what you've chosen, and many others like you have chosen as an occupation. And it is an altruistic occupation. But it's not conceivable to think that you should do it for free. It's not conceivable to think that it doesn't take a lot of money to heal someone, because as opposed to a broken leg or we could put a cast on it and heal it, recovery takes statistically 5 years. So you're talking 5 years of being involved with a healthcare provider at some level before we can say the likelihood of your long-term sobriety is very good. You know, I don't understand what society expects of us anymore. And I think that it's because they've continued to kick people. You know, this industry, we are the industry, we are the people who've always been kicked. And so it's convenient to do so because there's no one, except for people like you and I and others, who are going to stand up, open our mouths and advocate. Say, wait a second, hold on. You know, you've crossed the line now.
Right.
you know, and that's where we are today.
Well, Jeffrey, how can our listeners reach you if somebody wants to hire you or talk to you about the patient brokering laws or anything that's going on in the industry?
I mean, well, I have a blog website, which is soberlawnews.com. You can, my information is there. You know, I put that information up so people can get as educated as they can on the multitude of subjects that make up this very complicated healthcare paradigm. But you know, when people, you know, I always get frustrated when people need to hire me. It shouldn't be that way. There shouldn't be roadblocks to the delivery of necessary healthcare services, but there are. And that's where I come in and my law firm comes in. We deal with healthcare law. We deal with real estate. We deal with zoning. We deal with business planning. We deal with this very issue, which is counseling clients on legal marketing mechanisms, with how to avoid patient brokering, how to avoid being on the wrong side of the law, because so many people that I've met are well-intentioned but are just misinformed and are undereducated in this space. They've found sobriety, they've found religion, and now they want to share that with others. That's great. That doesn't necessarily qualify them as healthcare providers.
Right.
And they end up with mistakes, legal mistakes. And that's where, you know, we try to come in and be a resource as a consultant and educate in this space. But again, if you go to Sober Law News, you know, my information is there, or our legal website, our law website is bmulaw.com. And if anyone wants to call me, I'm always happy to talk to someone and educate them on what the law is.
Okay, great. I want to thank you for coming on today. And our listeners, again, this is Jeffrey Lynn, the attorney. And you can reach him. We'll have all his links and phone number up. And this is Unpause Your Life with Dr. Kaliestis.
Hey, everyone. Thanks again for listening. I really hope you enjoyed the show today. Head on over to iTunes and Apple Podcasts and leave a comment or review of what you think. Or contact us at 1-800-706-0318. If you want to be on our show, feel free to email or call. And if you have a topic, feel free to email or call as well.
Thanks for listening to Unpause Your Life. For show notes and more, head on over to unpauseyourlife.com.
Big shout out to recoveryinnovators.com for help producing this show. Thank you, guys.
Took a walk down the long road, the weather said that I shouldn't go. On my way found a reason to wake up another day. But they needed to show you all the things that you won't do. Find faith or religion, but nothing to show for it. No need to escape. In love with my pain. I may be awake, but I'm alive. Still alive. And I won't be bound by your mistake. No, I won't be randomly trapped at the gate. Down the dark road, where they said that I shouldn't go. I knew the dangers of flying. Now I'm so far from solid ground. But they needed to show you all the things that you won't do. Find faith or religion, but nothing to show for it. I may be weak, but I
give me something that's just-